Welcome everyone to CODEM X. This is the final CODEM X of the year. I would like to ask you all to turn off your phones and write down any questions you have. There'll be room for discussion at the end. Lou is now going to introduce our host of today.
Yes, our speaker today is a professor in artificial intelligence at the University of Applied Science in Utrecht. He is also a senior advisor to the Netherlands AI Coalition, and he's the founder of the Asimov Institute, which focuses on creativity in AI. So he should definitely be able to tell us something about creativity in AI. Please, a round of applause for Stefan Leinen.
So, hello all, it's great to be here. Thank you for the introduction. I'll skip my next slide because I'm hoping we'll have some time left at the end for questions, because this topic generally generates a lot of food for thought and discussion. So let's see. Let's start with this one. How many of you have an iPhone? Let's see, all right. How many of you who have an iPhone ever use Siri? Ah, yes. So statistically, this is all correct. If you ask Siri this question, this is the answer that you would get. And I would say for let's say someone who doesn't know much about how phones work, they might think that your phone is very intelligent, because making jokes is one of the most intelligent types of behavior there is. It's very difficult to create jokes with a computer, as I'll show you in a moment. For me, the reason why I think jokes are so interesting is because they're a type of creativity that are very interesting to study. And in fact, you can study them. So I took a relatively old piece of research. As you know, in IT, and particularly in AI, things move fast. So this is from 1994. And these researchers, they created a joke generator. And this is the output of the joke generator. And so you might think this is funny. If you don't think this is funny, that's also fine. But these jokes are, let's say, a little bit more generated by the computer than the joke you just saw before, because that one is just made up by a human. But if we take a look inside the system, so we don't look at it from, let's say, face value, but we look at what happens inside, then we find that there are all kinds of processes taking place where humans take part. So, for instance, there's a rhyme scheme. So we tell the program which words rhyme at each other. The computer doesn't know that. Which words have like opposite meanings or the same meanings. The semantic network formed between these words. We all give it to the computer. Then there's a randomizer. Then jokes come out. And not just the three jokes I showed you, but in fact, 188 of these jokes came out of the research. And what happens next is that we ask human evaluators to think about which jokes are funniest. Then, of course, the authors try to select the funniest jokes. And finally, I'm showing you the jokes I thought were funniest, because I want you to laugh at my presentation as well. So what you saw here, we could say it's artificial creativity, it's artificial intelligence, it's funny. Yes, but there's also a lot of human in the loop, both at the generating stage, but also at the evaluation stage. I think that's something very important to remember, not just with creativity, but any type of AI. It's always by humans and for humans. And it's a bit like, I don't know, you know, The Wizard of Oz? You've seen that movie or heard that story? At the end, there's this big robot face. And there's actually, they think that it's a real person, but there's actually a tiny little man behind the curtain that's actually moving the robot face. And Dorothy finds out, and then so she opens up the window, and then the man lets the robot say, "Don't look at the man behind the curtain." That's a bit like the state of AI right now. So there's always a human behind it. And this refers a little bit to the Turing test. How many of you know about this? Heard about this? Yeah? Majority, not everybody. So the idea is, how do you know a computer is intelligent? Well, what you can do is you could set up an experiment like this, where I'll give you the shortest version. You have someone who doesn't know if he's talking to a computer or a human, and you let them have two conversations, and then they need to predict which one was with the computer and which one was with a human. And if the prediction is about 50% accurate, then the computer passed the Turing test, because that's a gamble. If the human finds out more than 50%, significantly more, then didn't pass the Turing test, because then a human is able to find out. So the good news about this is that we have a way to sort of operationalize the idea of intelligence, right? We have a way to measure intelligence for computers. The bad news is that it takes two very stupid people to actually be fooled and have a smart computer. So two-thirds of these of this group of people needs to be stupid for one of them to be intelligent. So that's the downside of this, let's say, external way of looking at these systems. The other approach to AI is studying the processes inside. So like we just did with the joke generator, to going inside and seeing what's actually happening in there. Is this an intelligent process or not? And I want to tell you this story because it refers to this difference between what's on the outside and what's on the inside. So this is the Mechanical Turk. It's a robot device built in the 18th century. And it was actually very famous. It was made of, you know, wood and what did they make robots from in those days? I guess some metal and So a wooden robot that was able to play chess. And it traveled around the world. It went across the Atlantic Ocean. It played chess against Benjamin Franklin. It went across the courts in Europe. And in one very remarkable occasion, it played chess against Napoleon Bonaparte. And Napoleon was a very resourceful man because he wanted to find out the actual intelligence of this robot. So what did he do? He made a false move, a move that's illegal in chess. And he watched as the robot picked up the piece and put it back in place. And then Napoleon, he was more curious, so he made the same false move again. And then the robot took the piece and put it beside the chessboard. Then Napoleon put it back on the board, and the robot, with one swipe of his arm, moved all the chess pieces off the board. So Napoleon said, this must be very intelligent, because it's very creative. Well, it turned out it wasn't, because it wasn't a real robot, of course, in those days. They didn't know. They only found out much, much later. But there was a very tiny man inside. Nobody could believe he'd fit in there. And not only was he tiny, but he was also very good at chess. And the rumors are that after touring around the world for about 10 years, he got sick and tired of his job because he didn't get any fame, so he quit. And then the maker of the robot had to find someone else who was very tiny and was very good at playing chess. It was very difficult to find someone like that. So he could have used a robot. So even though this wasn't a real robot, it did provide inspiration for an inventor a little more than 100 years later, Charles Babbage, who was the creator of the first, what we now call computer, the analytical engine. This is a prototype just like it, a modern version. And Charles Babbage was inspired by this story about the Mechanical Turk because he thought, what would it take? What kind of device would it take to actually play chess, to have something intelligent? And this was used for calculations, but as we now know, decades later, we use it for all kinds of things. Anything that we can automate, that's the word we use right now with computers, right? Any thought process we can automate, we can use a computer for it. But we've reached, or it seems like we've reached some limitation of what we can automate, right? We know that the more and more complex these systems become, the more these big systems, look at like a Belastingdienst, tax office in the Netherlands, or some other like big corporations, multinationals. These IT systems have become very, very difficult to program. It's not because the teams are too small, or there's not enough funding, or people are not smart enough. They're very smart people are working there. It's just that the complexity of the matter just becomes too much for our tiny brains to comprehend. So what is the next step? Of course, I'm not this. Of course, I'm hinting at AI, but I'm giving you an example of a task that would be extremely difficult to program. I mean, I would challenge you all to make a computer program and without any AI tools, without any machine learning, but just an actual filter that could separate a muffin from a chihuahua picture. It could count the black dots, 3, but that wouldn't get you anywhere. And as you can see, I mean, we are already having a hard time sometimes separating it. But for a computer, this is very difficult. So what happened in these last couple of decades is that we found a new paradigm, a new way of creating these computer programs. And we call them models in machine learning. But the idea is still the same, that you have a kind of automated process that, in this case, gets you from input to output. And the way we built these models is different from what we're used to. We're used to thinking about, well, how do we count what, and how do we program this into a program? What we do now is we have this model, we feed it a data set, and we let the model evolve or learn over time, up until the point that we're satisfied with it, and then we say, now we have a program or model that is able to do this particular task. So it's a different way of creating programs, you might say, this whole machine learning. So we can dive a little bit into this, and then I'll get to the creativity part. How many of you know about machine learning or have experimented with it? Okay. So you're all sitting together somehow. That's interesting. Yeah, that's coincidence. Yeah, okay. They're also there. Yeah, so some of it might not be new, some of it might be new for you, but this is a very, very simplified neural network where we have the input, one of the pictures, and the output, the prediction of what this picture is, a dog or a chihuahua, right? And it goes in two stages. It goes from data transformation, so it's essentially counting pixels or pixel colors, to a label, and then a model update. So based on whether this prediction was right or wrong, we adjust the weights in a neural network, and that gives us a learning process. So we enter input, something comes back, etc. This is very simplified, but it's too simplified. It's not right. Because if we look at what would happen, right, in this model, what actually happens is an input, so a picture, gets projected into a space. We call this latent space. And if the model is untrained, we would expect all these images to be projected randomly over this space. There's no reason why a dog picture would be projected somewhere else than a chihuahua picture. But if over time we train the model, you hope that the dog pictures would all be in a certain area of this latent space, it projected out here, and the muffin picture would be projected out here. And that's nice, because if I now have a new picture that I enter of a dog, for example, based on the internal correlations of dog pictures alone, you would expect it to also end up somewhere around here. And then based on this projection, the separation of those two classes, you could have a prediction of this new picture. It's never seen it before, but it would be able to say with a certain certainty it's a dog or it's a muffin. That's the idea. But how does it work in practice? Well, how many pixels are there? Well, many pixels. And what's a pixel? How do we make an input signal, which is just a number between one and zero, out of a picture? Well, what we do is we say, well, let's discount what doesn't matter. So what do we see here? Who's able to say what we see here? Type of sport, okay. Animal. Any other ideas? Ball, net. We go, group. Yeah. Yeah. Pixels, colors, lots of green. That's what a computer might think. So it really depends on the level of sort of what do you define as features. We could say we define as features, is this a sport or not? Is there a horse, a ball, and a net? Or the percentage of green pixels? They're all valid features. And we have to choose a certain level where we start to count. And you see the same thing in this approach, where we say, well, how do we transform a picture to a neural network input? Well, let's assume, in this case, that color doesn't matter. And let's then also assume that, I mean, these are lots of pixels. Let's sort of group them together, right? Let's sort of classify them. And then we make the problem space a lot smaller. It's much more easier to learn. So we actually transform this picture into the features that we think are important. And then we do the machine learning part. That's what happens under the hood. But in these transformations, something happens. Our assumptions are being transferred into the learning problem. So how do we know these things are not important? We don't really know, but we assume it because we have to solve a problem. And these are the steps where we sort of slowly decrease our search space, which affect the creativity of the system. That's my main point. I'll get to that. So it would look a little bit like this. So these are all the possible, let's say, transformations you could have in this latent space that I showed you. But because we have assumptions, because we need to decide which features are important or not in a given problem for machine learning, we sort of shrink down this expected space. And we have to, because otherwise the learning, it would be untrainable. It would take too much time to actually learn a problem like this. So let me give you an example why this is important. This is the nine-dot problem. It's very famous. The challenge here is to have, let's say you put a pen on paper and you have five strokes, so you have five lines you can draw. You're not allowed to put the pen off the paper. And, Not this problem, no. Yeah, we'll get there, yeah. In this case with five, that's a good point. How do you solve it? So you have to connect all the dots with five strokes. An S, yeah, let's see, so like this. Yeah, or that's a five actually, yeah. That would be one way to solve it. This is a different way, but it's the same idea. So let's imagine that we create a computer program that should solve this problem. With 5 strokes, we'll get to 4. With 5 strokes, how do you connect the dots? Well, you could have something like this. We represent the dots as a problem representation, and then we say, well, a solution looks like this. So it's a path through these dots, and this will be randomly generated. So is this a solution to our problem? Let's see, so 2 to 5, 5 to 9, 9 to 1, 2 to 4, 2 to 8. No, it didn't hit the 3 and 7, for example. So this is not a solution to our problem. So finally, what we have a function over a generated solution that would give you a false or a true if it solved it or not. And then what we could do is we could generate these until we find a true, and then we found a solution to our problem. So that's a typical programming approach. But imagine, and this is what the real world looks like, that the problem changes. So what we now have is 4 strokes. But we are stuck with our solution that we had before. So the problem changes, the solution is the same. Would this program be able to figure out what the solution is? No. What does the solution look like? Like from here? Which box? Yeah. And you go up, and you go back. Yeah, I will transformed, but same idea, yeah. So this box, it's an implicit assumption, of course. It's an assumption by the programmer. It's not an assumption we make here, but it's an assumption that we make back here. And here it works for us, here it's fine. So in our problem representation, we already have this box, so we don't have dots out here that we can connect to. So it's fine now, but if the problem changes, it's not fine anymore. And so this is a real problem, because if we develop programs, we always have these implicit assumptions, the same with the Chihuahua picture, that we put into the solution, and then if the problem changes, it doesn't work for us anymore. And this is not how we work. We are able, as humans, to shift this box around, to continually adapt the way we solve problems, not just the problem itself, but the way we solve problems. That's very interesting. And it also points out a critical flaw in our approach, which we don't have as humans. So I call this the box paradox. So either we as humans, as engineers, have to transform the search space of the solution, or the solution is already in the search space. In both cases, it's not creative. What we need is a system that creates its own search space. So that's a big challenge. We haven't solved it yet, but I'll give you some pointers to where the solution might lie. How are we doing in time? Yeah, I'll skip this. Okay, it's basically the same, but then a thought experiment. So this is what we need to do, think outside the box. And what I did here is I drew 2 boxes, as you can see. So you have the, let's say, the big box of all the physical possibilities, so anything that can be represented. And then you have the smaller box of your program, which already has some assumed assumptions. So the challenge is not to do something which is impossible, right? So if we talk about creativity, we're not talking about being able to fly suddenly. That's not creativity. It's within the means that we have, find alternative ways to a problem. So this is more what it would look like. We have a search space, we transform our own search space within what's possible. So to give you an example of what it would look like, this is an experiment done by Google DeepMind. They do some pretty interesting research. Here the domain, problem domain, is game playing. So they have a reinforcement learning agent. They use these deep learning networks. And the agent learns a policy of how to play a game. This game is Atari Breakout. So what's interesting about this, it's programmed differently than what we're normally doing in game AI. Normally, we would tell the program, this is your score, this is a block, this is a ball, this is a bet, you need to do this and that and that. So all these implicit assumptions in there. And then finally, very quickly, it would find a policy to solve this and play the game well. But what they did is something else. What the input to the network was the pixels. And they didn't tell it what was a ball, what was a bet, what was a block, etc. They only showed it the score, and the program was able to go left and right. So it had to figure out all the features by itself. So it made an implicit representation of what a bet is and what the ball is, etc. And because it had this, it created its own representations, this allowed for a particular type of creativity. Because it didn't have our assumptions on how you should play this game, so it figured out for itself a way to play this game that we probably wouldn't have thought of. Let's see. Yeah, it's pretty efficient. That's very interesting to see as a researcher that your own program sort of, well, surpassed you. I mean, this is not something that the programmers thought of themselves. But the way they did it is they relaxed the constraints on what on their expectations, on their assumptions. And by doing that, they allowed for more creativity in the program, ultimately. So it's a bit like this. In this case, a style, you can think of a game playing style. Whoa, a lot of light. So what made this possible? And this is a bit like, so why do we have AI now? What's so interesting about deep learning? Well, suddenly we have skill. So the reason why we couldn't do this before is we didn't have the GPUs, we didn't have the data, the storage power, etc. So in the last 20 years, we see these sort of exponential curves going everywhere. And this is what allows us to suddenly do it. Because it's also important to remember that the techniques that are used are not new. Most of them come from the 90s, some come from the 80s. Some of them were invented in the last 20 years, but most of them have been on the shelves of universities for a very long time. It's just that now we have the means to actually do these kind of researches. And so what we see is, you know, this is, I think, ImageNet. I think he was one of the first, Sutskever was one of the first AI researchers to sort of renew this field about 7-8 years ago. Key factors: sufficiently fast computers, availability of labeled data set algorithms, etc. And there's also, let's say, shadow side of it. There's a more difficult side. Rodney Brooks, he's also one of the first AI researchers back in the 80s and 90s. And he's talking about these assumptions that we have to put in. He's talking about this man behind the curtain that we often try to sort of shove away, because we like people to think and we like the audience to think that AI is all doing it by itself. But it's actually not. There's a lot of man work behind it. And this is what we now call data preparation. And, you know, that's the man work behind it. So that's how we go further in the paradigm. How do we remove ourselves from this man work? So we're talking about skill. We're talking about big networks. Does anybody know why we call it deep learning? Yeah, maybe. You can try. Yeah. Well, that's the learning part. Yeah. Why deep? What levels? We say. I don't know if there's an official definition, but deep learning always refers to these neural networks, which are models. So like your program is a model, but you could also think of this as a model. It's just more abstract. We don't know what's in there. We don't know what it means. It's a black box, but it's a model. And deep means that it has more than one hidden layer. So you have the input layer. This is where the image comes in. Then you have the output layer, which tells you dog or muffin. And then if it has one hidden layer, it's not deep. But if it has more than one hidden layer, we call it deep learning. So it's a relatively straightforward definition. But what these deep networks have allowed us to do is actually do a lot of what we call automated feature detection. So the color of the image, the pixelation size, the type of policy for playing, what's a bet, what's a ball, all these kind of questions that previously as programmers we had to figure out, or basically we had to guess which ones are important or not. The network can now figure them out for themselves. And if you sort of, I mean, you can't really look into the network because you just see ones and zeros and it's a mess, but there are tools that you can use to sort of do introspection in this network. And this network, I mean, it's interesting, it's for face recognition. So you put the, like this, raw data on this side, and then at the end you do, is this a man or a woman, for example. And what you see is if you sample different parts of this network in the low levels, you get these low level features. And this is pretty much how our visual cortex also works. We also have these recognitions. And then mid-level, you get eye and nose, and then up-level, you get faces, yeah? A good question, but very difficult, yeah. I mean, I won't go into it because of time, but what you do is you shake it a little bit and you look at the differences, if that makes sense. So you give it slightly different inputs, and then you see where the big differences are. So another way of looking at it, if I give it this input, which part triggers most? And then it's this part. If I get that input, then you see the biggest differences on this side. So it's This is a field of research. So how do we sample? How do we look at this? If we talk about transparent AI, if we talk about explainable AI, it's about these questions. Yeah. Okay. So back to this sort of thinking outside the box, inside the box, or creative part. So we had this, right? Because I'm going to show you. Yeah, I'm going to show you some examples of how this can be creative. And how much fun it is to play around with. But before we go into the examples, I just want to make sure to get my main point across, which is this is very impactful, this paradigm shift, this idea that we're no longer bound by our own intelligence, but we now have a system which can learn without our assumptions. So the upper bound of the problems that we're solving is suddenly it's released. There's no reason why we wouldn't be able to solve a problem anymore, because a machine can learn it with enough data and models, et cetera, computing time. So it's a very interesting paradigm. It will hit us in all sectors and all fields. I think it will be something that's alongside of normal programming. So that's the disclaimer. So now we go into the fun stuff, but it's not just fun, it's also important. Okay. So another way of looking at it. So let's say we have a classifier for cats. So we input an image of a cat, and then we say, well, cats are around here in our space. What we can do is we can turn it around. We can also say, well, if I now select a point in this latent space, in this model, what does it look like? So we can ask the model, dream up a cat. This is what you get. So these are cats that don't exist. If you recognize your own cat in here, your cat doesn't exist. These are made up by the network. And as I was making this presentation, I noticed that this is from 2016, which is ages ago in AI land. So I looked up something which is more recent. So this is from last year. If you go to a website called thispersondoesntexist.com, you can just refresh the page. You get people who don't exist. So if you need a fake passport or anything, use this. Don't do identity fraud. Another one, person doesn't exist. It's funny because you can see it at the edges of the picture. There it doesn't make sense anymore because the AI has not been trained to give good backgrounds. It's been trained to give a realistic face. It sort of averages over different backgrounds, and it has, you know, because every picture has a background. But it's not, let's say, it's not selected for. It's not important for its success. What's important is the face itself, if it's recognized as a face. So you get these strange artifacts around it. And we can also do that with, you're right. Maybe your cat's in here as well. It's possible, yeah. But it's not generated based on an existing person. So it's an average face, you could say, or, well, not average. No, so if you go to the website, you click refresh, it's not from a database. It's generated for you, and as soon as you click refresh, it's gone. So it's, No. Yeah. So, well, I mean, it's a similar question to your previous question. You turn the model around. So you, instead of going from, where were we? Yeah, here. Instead of going from a picture to a classification, you say, I want this classification. Now show me your retina. Show me what you're thinking about. So you generate this. The technique is more complex than that, but. Yeah, and it's not like you can just turn around networks, but so it's ongoing research as well, but there are ways of doing it. If I have time, I can show you one of these techniques, and then it will make a lot of sense how you do it. Actually, it will be. It's not that difficult, actually. But, yeah. Okay. And then after this question, I think I'll move on with the story because else there's too much.
If you run the program for a second time, do you hit the same result?
No. In fact, if you refresh the page. It's basically running the program again, but with a different random seed. So if you use the same random seed, you'd get the result, of course. But there's lots of randomness in the generation process, so that's why you get a different one every time. Yeah. Okay. If you have questions, just keep them until the end. I'm sure we'll have some time left. Okay. So you can do it with paintings as well. So this is a Rembrandt that doesn't exist. There's a little bit more human work than with the previous one. I mean, this one doesn't generate from a website. This is a month-long project. But what they did is they looked at existing Rembrandts, sort of extracted the coloring techniques and the patterns and the features and light, etc., and then they generated this. So now we can paint with painters that don't exist anymore. We can do something else, something similar with
applying the system
photos. In each case, what's interesting about this is just a couple of months old, so it's still moving forward quite fast. What's interesting about this is just one-shot prediction, we call it. So we get one picture, and it's on that side now, one picture, and based on that, we can generate animation. And because it's just one picture, we can also do it with people we don't have any motion capture or motion pictures of. I mean, I think we have videos of Einstein. But as I showed you, it doesn't just work for pictures, it also works with paintings. So we get this nice sort of Harry Potter kind of effect.
The large domain gap between paintings and YouTube videos.
And it's all just generated from this picture.
Here, we can see that in some cases...
Yeah, never predicted this would happen.
...sensitive to the geometry of the landmarks.
All right. We could do other fun stuff. Because what we essentially did with this model is we transformed a picture into a set of numbers, because a dot in this latent space is just a vector. It's a set of numbers. Now, when I show you a latent space with three dimensions, it's just because I'm not very good at drawing in four or more dimensions, but there's actually, like, you can imagine there are thousands of different dimensions, right? So this is a huge space in terms of dimensionality. And one part of this space, we have this dog, and another part of this space, we have the flower. And of course, because they're numbers, we can average the numbers out, and you finally get to know what a flower dog looks like. We can do something similar with a geyser and a dog. It's like this. And if you ever wondered what it would look like if you'd have a crossover between your dog and a cappuccino, it looks like this. So it's endless fun playing around with it. You might ask, why always these dogs and cats? Anybody know why it's always dogs and cats in these examples? Yes, that's one, yeah? Yeah. No, I think the reason I've heard is closer to that. So where do we take the pictures? From the internet, and there's lots of cats and dogs on the internet. So that's how the models are trained usually. That's the reason I know, but I'm not sure. We can do the similar thing with style transfer. Then we don't average it out, but we take like we take the style of this picture, so the colors and effects, and we put it on the content. And here are the effects. So this is all automated. You can play around with this online if you have Snapchat, Instagram. There's probably also some techniques of this behind it. I think Snapchat filters more or less use this technique. But we don't even know where it ends, because this is all very, very recent. So we can do it with pictures, but we can also do it with video. Let's see. Yeah, this. I want to show it because I just like the. So what we have is motion video, and we have a style image for painting. This is the first try. So you see the Starry Night Van Gogh, but if they apply some sort of secondary techniques to smoothen it out, we actually get the effect we want. So, Munch, the scream, and then some animation here. And so there's no human work involved anymore. This is just applying a certain painting on a certain motion picture. There's lots of more examples, but found online. All right, I'll show you one more example project, which we did with these techniques at the Asimov Institute, and then I think we have time for questions. So the R&D was as follows. This is the team. Amber Jay, she's a virtual fashion designer. She studied at Amphi, and we wanted to make a statement. We wanted to say that the fashion industry is not creative anymore. And how do we prove this? Well, if a computer can predict what next year's fashion will look like, then either the computer is very creative or the industry is not. That was our main point. So what we did is we took these photos, I say took, we stole them, from a website, And we put them into one of these models. So same as the cat models, et cetera, that I showed you. And then we asked the model, can you generate for us an image like this? Of course, I mean, this is not a design, but it can serve as inspiration. So this is sort of, we try to create, set up a creative process where a human and a computer would interact. And so Amber J then used this image as inspiration for her new collection. So we call this computational inspiration. So the idea is that we have a designer has a search space, like I want something like this. And then the computer expands the search space with these techniques. And then the designer takes this expansion and then sort of iterates on it in a creative way. I'll show you the example. I'll show you the results first, and then I'll go into the technique because that's, I think that's an interesting question, maybe how it works. So this is what the data set that is generated by this model, and these are the some examples of what she made out of it. It's a conceptual. It's not something you would wear. I think I wouldn't. Let's see. Yeah, this one. That's animated. She called the collection Deep, which is a sort of a nod to the techniques that were used after it. I think this is the last one. Yeah, okay. I'll spend a couple of minutes on the technique and then we can go to questions. So this is one way of doing it. How do we generate these models? Well, we in this case, we use a generative adversarial network. GAN, G-A-N. And it consists of two neural networks, a generator and a discriminator. And what we essentially do is a sort of a Turing test. So we let the system do a Turing test on itself. How does it work? We have the image data set over here. So we randomly pick images from this data set. We have a generator which generates, in the beginning, random noise, or just generates random images. And then we have a discriminator network, which has to choose which one is the real image and which one is the generated image. So is this real or fake? Which one is real and which one is fake? And so the discriminator in the beginning has an easy time figuring that out because it knows this one is real. But over time, these generator images become, well, maybe by random chance, become more realistic, or they start looking like one of these just randomly. And then the discriminator makes a mistake and it thinks that this one is a real image. So then this one gets points. So it knows, oh, okay, I'm a bit closer to my target right now. And if you let this run over time, it's a very difficult, unstable process, but you can make it work, then the generator will start producing images which fool the discriminator. And if the discriminator is fooled, let's say 50% of the time, then it starts guessing. That means that these images to the computer look a lot like these images. And that's when you sort of said, well, then I'm done training my generator. And then you can use, so you can take this generator and you can sort of, you know, output as many images as you want, similar with the fake faces, etc. So, but this is the training process to sort of get this generator up to speed, to get it to learn. That's one way of doing it. There's many ways of doing it. So yeah, so it starts generating something like this. Of course, this is not realistic, but we were happy with it. So it's also 3 years ago, which is a long time. Okay, I think I've reached the end of my presentation. Thank you. Start there.
So you have the catch box before you speak.
It felt like a very aimed throw, but it's yeah.
I don't know, is it? Yeah, a little bit. Could you go back two slides? Back to where you had the schematic of the generator and such. Yeah.
Yeah.
So if the generator starts producing white noise, how will it ever come close to the real world image there? Like, yeah. I don't understand this, like how, because it needs to get a certain reward when it gets closer.
Yeah.
But if the discriminator is trained properly, it'll never give the generator that reward because it's not going to randomly produce a human out of
yeah. Reward, right? I think there's two parts. One part is that it's stepwise. So we don't need the generator to generate something like this straight away because the probability would just be too low. But we needed to generate something that fools the discriminator. It can be something that's like minor, like almost a little bit different from this, but it fools the discriminator. That's one part. The second part is the discriminator is also learning. So this is not a perfect human size discriminator, it's also undergoing a training process where it makes a lot of mistakes.
So do they both start from scratch?
Yeah.
Both the generator and the discriminator?
They're sort of learning at the same time.
Yeah.
And so this is why this with GANs, you often have a balancing act. Because if one of them wins too soon, you don't get good results. So they need to be balanced against each other in order to get a good result here. It's a very difficult training process.
You can also kind of cheat by using the learning for the discriminator in training the generator, right?
Yes. Well, no, you do that. You do that. So there's a feedback signal from the discriminator to the generator. Otherwise, the generator would never know if it's on the right path. So in fact, the mistakes made by the generator is the positive score of the... by the discriminator is a positive score of the generator. So if this one tries to fool the discriminator, and if it succeeds, then it gets a reward.
All these examples are for images. Is there anything for music or something?
Yeah. It's, I don't have it in this presentation, but we did another project with a DJ, where we and this is a bit like let's see the style transfer. Where is it again? This one. This one. So we did a little bit something like this. So you can put audio samples and also plot them into latent space. They're much more difficult. One reason is that they're sort of over time. So there's lots of data points, and which one do you select? So if you do it with, like, say, small sound bites or like in video games, you know, these sound effects, you can do it pretty well. You can generate sound effects. If you do it for music, there's just so much complexity in there, and that's one reason. The second is the structure is much more complicated. So with images, there's spatial structure. So pixels that look alike tend to be next together, relatively speaking. With music, there's nothing like that. There's no space. And in time, things don't have to look alike because the patterns are typically not connected to each other. So it's a very different and very complicated latent space. But what we managed to do is to extract the style of this DJ out of his songs. Again, another problem, not a very big data set because they don't produce that many songs, not millions of songs. Extract the style and then apply it to a different song. And then the DJ took that again. His name is DJ Gecko. I don't know, it's like hardstyle, not my style. And then he used this output as an inspiration for his new songs, which then came on this album. I have a separate presentation about generative music, but that's another hour, so I don't want to fill the time. Yeah, all right. Yep.
So I was just wondering, when you were talking about the random people, so you say if you go to this latent space, you put a lot of training things in it, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
But if you would, by a chance if you would pick that exact point in latent space where you put in information earlier, would you get back the original picture? Or is it sort of gone? Do you understand my question?
Yeah, but by chance. So in this latent space, your face is also in there. Yeah. If you have the right random number, you get...
So, yeah. For example, if you would use like Google Image for all these kinds of portraits of people, and you put them all in latent space, and you would have that latent space to generate your new random picture, right?
Yeah.
If you go to the right spot, would the original picture still be in there somewhere?
Mm. So that depends a bit on this transformation. So what happens is you determine this. I need a different picture. Let's see. Yeah, this one might be better. Yeah. So this is the first process, right? So these are images from Google Image. They're projected into latent space. What I don't mean to say is that this exact image is in there. It's just that this image gets transformed to a vector. And in this case, it's a three-dimensional vector because I only have three dimensions. So that means that if I would go from this three-dimensional vector back to the image, I wouldn't get the image because I lose information. Because the space where the image is projected to has a, let's say, higher density. It has less information than the original image. if I would select a space which has just as much information as the original image, or let's say could express this, you could have a symmetric transfer of data. So I could sort of do it backwards as well, which is why a couple of years ago we only had like low pixel images. So I think the question is a bit more, it's nuanced, because is your cat in here? Well, the chance that you would find something that looks like your cat is a lot higher than to find something like this, like your face, because the space that's projected to is just more pixelated. So yeah, but I guess ultimately we're aiming for this. So you need huge latent spaces, and in practice you have a lot of information loss. So I think in practical systems, our faces wouldn't be in there. It's just the space is too big, maybe. But maybe in the future. Yeah. Does that sort of answer it? Okay. Yeah. Okay.
So I was just wondering, say you want to train a neural network to recognize Rembrandts, but you only have a data set of a few Rembrandts. Don't you... isn't there a risk of overfitting where your network just kind of memorizes all the Rembrandts because you're using all of them to train it? And if you're not using all of them to train it,
yeah,
it won't be good enough. But then, you know, it's not really making extrapolations. It's rather just remembering all the Rembrandts.
Yeah. Like
how would you circumvent that?
Remembranding. Yeah, no, it would be something like that. Yeah. So that's a problem of overfitting. And the smaller your data set, typically... bigger the risk of overfitting. So there are techniques to prevent overfitting. Some of them focus on the data set. Those are typically very fruitful. So you can generate more data, or let's say you put randomness or bias in the data to prevent overfitting. Some of the methods, they focus on the model itself. How do you create models that don't generally overfit? And some of them look at the learning process. And so how do you, you know, sort of reuse these images in such a way you don't get overfitting or throw out the data? There's a couple of techniques, but yeah.
Things like some white noise over like some random pixels that are different, or that you tilt the angle or you cut out certain things.
Yeah,
I
mean, it really it depends on the problem. So this is why this field is also so complicated, because it's ongoing research. It's essentially only a couple of years old. I mean, techniques are very old, but these problems start appearing only when you apply them practically. And there's not many people who actually understand this stuff. Everyone's read there's like 10,000 people in the world who actually know how deep learning works, like fundamentally know. And there's always different levels in that. So to get someone to actually fix this problem for you, if you have a company, that's really difficult, because it's alchemy. We don't really have good theory about it.
I have a question. So since you spend so much time researching around the AI topic, what do you think would be a cool application of AI that is not currently possible, or that you look forward to in the future? Mm.
That's really difficult. I mean, my interest personally is in the big questions. I think that goes for a lot of AI researchers. I mean, we didn't get into the field because we want to build search engines or something. We're talking about what is emotion, what is consciousness, how do we model this, how do we, you know, those kind of the big questions. What I've learned over time is through these machines, I get to know more about humans. So those are the deepest questions ultimately. So if we study artificial intelligence or artificial creativity or consciousness, of course we care about the products, but we also understand more about ourselves. So I think those are the deep fundamental questions that we've been able to chase for thousands of years. I mean, these are old questions, they come from early philosophy. But suddenly we're in a time where we're actually able to experiment with them. So we actually, if someone tells me I have a theory about what consciousness is, I tell them, fine, build a robot that's conscious and then show me. And if they say, well, I can't build a robot, they say, well, then what's your theory? Why not? What's the problem? So we're in a time where we could do something like practical philosophy. And so this is what attracts me to the field. That's what I find most interesting. I think your question is a little bit more geared towards sort of a product, or so what's coming up next? It's really difficult. Like self-driving cars, of course, nice, but not easy. We're starting to learn that self-driving cars on a highway is probably possible, but in you know, on the street. That's like in the city center of Amsterdam. That's a really difficult question to answer. I think there will be a lot more about personalization. So your learning, your curriculum right now, who determines which courses you need to follow and when and what questions you get? It's all human assumptions. It's either you choose it or your teacher or your parent or, you know. I think that's a very interesting question. Why don't we let a computer decide what your next exam question should be or what book you should read in order to sort of maximize your progress? So that's something about personalization that's very interesting. It's also very dangerous. It's also something like, what happens if we do this? What are the effects? So, yeah. Some ideas, yeah. Okay, good. I thought I scared everybody with talking about exams. Yeah, good.
Cheers. Yeah, it works great.
Yeah.
More of an overarching question, especially since that's kind of your area of interest also. There's a lot of lay people who don't know very much about AI, but some people are quite fearful of it. Other people think it's the bee's knees. You're an actual expert in this area. Like, are there actual reasons to fear AI? And if so, what specific instances or ways of implementation would be risky, according to you?
Yeah. I'm an expert in the sense that I have experience with it, but it doesn't mean I can look into the future, of course. So it's... I think one risk that's been, overestimated by Hollywood is the idea of, you know, the Terminator scenario. It might be a risk, but it's not a risk right now because these things don't want anything. It's always people behind it that want something. And I think that's a very actual risk. So when I talk about the big companies and, also governments, there are people behind those governments and people behind those companies that have drivers. It's making profit or, you know, control or information. And these are tools that you can actually use to do, you know, mass surveillance or get to know someone personally without ever interacting with them or those. So I think those are the most urgent questions right now, but they're not new. I think that we've had them for a long time. We know about data. AI is just another, you know, tool in the, another instrument in the toolbox for these organizations. So for me, AI governance is a very interesting question. How do you, what kind of organization or way of, you know, arranging this do you need in order to make sure it goes well? That's one of my research interests. Explainability, transparency, of course. So understanding what happens, also explaining it to the general audience. Something that we do with the AI Coalition is we try to really make sure people understand it's not just downsides. Because media like to focus, and Hollywood, they like to focus on the downsides of these theories. But there's a reason why we're applying it. There's a reason why we want self-driving cars. It's because we get less accidents. And then, of course, there are all these sort of edge cases and all these risks that we need to take care of. That's true. But sometimes it's like we forget about the reason for wanting a self-driving car. So I think getting that on the attention also helps. So to get a balanced debate. Yeah. Does that sort of answer it for you? Or is it? Yeah.
As sort of a hook on, and then I'll let go. Some people are also wondering, like, if AI becomes more and more human-like, and at some point people are gonna try to make like an actual electronic human, that's, you're gonna also have to give them things like human rights and whatnot. I'm also wondering, always wondering, why would we? If you want a human, just use a human.
Yeah. I think, I will give you a confident message. I think we're very far removed from creating a human. In fact, I think if we ever have the interest of building something human-like, a computer is probably the worst place to start. Because a computer is everything that we're not. That's why we built it. It's something that's repetitive, always does the same thing. It needs energy, but that's easily taken care of. You know, you just plug it in and then it has energy. It doesn't have to go look for food or water or anything. So it has completely different concerns. I think it has no concerns, actually. So I do believe it's in our potential to build something that's like us. I think if we start with a computer, we're probably further from home than if we don't. So, yeah, it's the path we're on right now. We're nowhere near consciousness and emotion and all these kind of things. I don't think we're that close. But that's also just a prediction. And the future of predictive systems is hard to predict, unfortunately.
Yeah. Somewhat similar, yeah. But do you believe that it's even theoretically possible to create artificial general intelligence. So an AI that, you know, is able to learn about a wider range of things, sort of the same way that we can adapt and learn new things on the fly. Because right now, usually an AI is very good at this one particular thing.
I was very curious about your definition of artificial. That's why I was listening, like artificial general intelligence. Like, what is the definition? So if you take the definition of learning more general things rather than a task specifically, or, you know, that's sort of covered in transfer learning in AI. So that's a research area that deals with how can we apply what we learn in one problem domain, how we can apply it to something else. So if I recognize chihuahuas, will it help me make better music? Something like, I mean, those crossovers, right? But that's you could call that artificial general intelligence, but there's of course much more to being human. So I think one fundamental thing about humans is that we create our own goals. Computers don't create goals. They are given an objective function or a selective function. We tell them what to do, always. Sometimes they don't do what we want them to do, but it's not because they want something else, it's because it don't work or they're, you know, not programmed well. And that's a very fundamental difference, I think. And it's not something that you can just solve with better software or, you know, a new paradigm in AI or machine learning. It's really ingrained into the physical architecture of the computer. It doesn't have goal. It's not organized as a goal finding system. And we are. So yeah.
We have time for one more question up front here.
Hi, Stefan. So you mentioned that learning about artificial intelligence helps you to better understand real human intelligence. Can you kind of elaborate a bit more and maybe give us some example of what you have learned in your career about human intelligence?
I think there's a bridge with the previous question. So I think this, because when I started, I had this assumption that anything that you can understand, you can just model in a computer. It's just, you know, you just go to the atom level. And then you sort of, suppose we have this Star Trek holodeck and we sort of scan a human body and then we transform it to a simulation. Then you essentially have AI, right? I don't think that anymore. I don't think it works that way, because if you transfer these atoms, you also transfer the entire way the atoms interact with the environment. And so you have to basically make a copy of the world in your computer. If you really think it through, it becomes really complicated to make something like that. So I think our approach to something like this type of AI would be to understand the processes. So why is it that, this person is not conscious and you are? Why? Or this is not a person, of course, but this screen is not conscious or this roof is not conscious, but you are. What is the difference? And I don't think the answer lies in a particular particle. I think it's a configuration. It's a process that we sort of go through. What type of process? Well, then we have to understand humans. Then we have to understand biology, the psychology, the philosophy of humans. And by building it, it's a very interesting way of analyzing. So anything you can build, you pretty much understand. So this is sort of a stepwise process towards understanding. And for me, this sort of goal-directedness is one building block that I found in my research, that we have a fundamentally, biology has a fundamentally different way of structuring systems to have them teleological systems, so goal-directed systems, are fundamentally different from the sort of formal systems that we use in computers. So I think that's one building block, but there's many more to find, of course. So we're nowhere near the answer. That's good news, because there's work for us. So we're not done yet. Yeah.
Thank you all for coming. The next CodeMX will be at the 8th of January. So we hope to see you all then. One big round of applause for our speaker today.